So, are you now seeing the
Yep.
full screen?
Yep, now it works.
Okay.
Yep, I see it.
Perfect. Thank you very much. Good. So, after a little bit of confusion, we can start now. We originally planned for Marcus to share the screens because he has more slides, but then we just switched it around. So, welcome to our talk about the SUSE security team. Everything has been a bit interesting, I heard, with the presentation software, so let's hope it works. This is our agenda for today. So, I will give you a short introduction into the team. Then, Marcus will take over and talk about reactive security. I'll talk about proactive security, and then we give you a short summary and some outlook. So, first, let's introduce ourselves. So, my name is Johannes Sigitz. I'm a security engineer at SUSE, and my email address, of course, only consists of the first part. I unfortunately don't have the really current slides, those are with Marcus. And now, Marcus, you can introduce yourself, please.
Yeah, I'm Markus Meissner. I'm with SUSE for 18 years now, since 2002, and with security for 16 years now. I'm project manager for security, and I oversee our security response or reactive part, as we refer to it. Okay, next
Okay.
slide.
So, this is a short introduction of the team. This is mainly for reference. I will not go through all of that. It's just that if you ever get contacted by one of the security guys, you can use this to see who we actually are. So, Markus is with us, so he's the project manager. You might have seen him since he's very active on OpenSUSE also. Apart from that, we of course have a team lead, Ivan, and we, since a few months, have a certification project manager, Katja, that's mostly relevant for the SLES side. And then we have a whole slew of security engineers, which I'm one of them. And currently, we have also two open positions. So we look for a reactive and a proactive engineer. We'll talk about reactive and proactive soon. But if you're interested in doing security work and have some experience there, then now is a good time to apply. And I can tell you it's a great team and we have a lot of fun. So, we have this split into reactive and proactive. So the reactive side mainly deals with security issues that are already known or will soon be known. So this is mostly about security issues that had already been researched. Markus already mentioned that he's overseeing this, and then we have four security engineers working on this. On the proactive side, we mainly deal with securing our products before they come out. So there we audit programs and system services. So we do a lot of work for systemd, DBus services, and also for network-facing daemons. And we also approve product releases. So especially for OpenSUSE, before an OpenSUSE release happens, we have a look and see if we are happy with the security posture of the system. So it basically encompasses all of the security work that is done before shipment, and that is done by the security engineers listed below there. So with that, let's step over to reactive security, and Markus, please take it away.
Yeah, thank you, Johannes. Next slide. So, directive security, we call it internally, is basically what other or industries understand with product security incident response, meaning we react on reported security issues in our products. Products encompass here the SUSE Enterprise line, the SUSE Manager, Cloud, and so on, and also OpenSUSE Leap and OpenSUSE Tumbleweed. As this is quite an amount of work and it needs a bit more structure, we have defined roles, how we do the work. We'll be going in detail on them a bit in a minute. We have so-called incident managers and the so-called update manager. Our role in this process is coordinating from begin to end, from getting the knowledge of a security incident to the release of the incident, but delegate all the work that is in between to and required. So, like fixing the security issue, we delegate to the package maintainer, source review, to the source review teams, testing to QA, and only once when everything is finished reviewing, then we release the update. We also supply additional documentation if it's needed. A lot of that is automated, but we also supply other human and also machine readable information. Next slide, please. So how does it work? So the incident manager, basically, if we get knowledge of a new issue, we open a Bugzilla entry in the SUSE Security Incidents product. This is public, visible to the public. We have a standardized summary format line, as we have a lot of tooling in the background that uses these summaries to process stuff further. So a val-0, 1 or 2 prefix, then the CVE ID as prefix, the source package name as prefix, and finally the short summary. The initial comment, the description of the Bugzilla, we fill with the textual description with references, links. We attach patches and report users to these bug reports. And last but not least, we assign it to the packager and bug owner of the package. Parallel to that, we have an internal tool called Smash that we use for everything that is not possible with Bugzilla. So we use this as one hand as a ticketing system to track all incoming CVEs. We do security issue rating inside this tool, both a simplified rating and the industry common vulnerability scoring system version 3.1 scoring. We declare what software is affected and what software is not affected for SUSE Linux Enterprise in this tool. We have plans to do that also for OpenSUSE and also with Leap and Jump, inheriting a lot of packages from SUSE Linux Enterprise that is not that relevant, but interesting nonetheless. And we plan the update for start the update now out of that tool. Next slide, please. to give you a view on what we are processing on incoming issues. So this is just the things that affect us. So this is the bugs that affect us. So that the scale goes from 2006, and here on my screen, it sadly is a bit hidden behind the other windows. So we started for a long time around 10 bugs per week. So these are bugs per week and are now at the point of where we have like 20, 25, 35 bugs per week. You see here starting a lot of noise in the 2015, 2016 area. This is the time where fuzzing became much more prominent in the security world, where, for instance, the American Fuzzy Lob Fuzzer was introduced, and people started to fuzz Image Magic, for instance. A big number of these spikes can be attributed to Image Magic. Next slide, please. So our tool Smash, that is accessible only internally because it also tracks embargo security information for efficient reasons. It's only referenced internally. That's a tool we wrote on our own. So basically, we have this incoming issue view, the new issues. Here we see bug coming from Bugzilla. We see bug coming from the CVE and VD feed. All these are imported automatically, and the update manager goes and processes them from this queue. Next slide, please. Once the update manager, the incident manager is processing them, you see that everything is associated with a Bugzilla entry. We have this rating. We have opened the, there do you see the bug report, the bug summaries, and on the right side, you see the affected packages. I will not go into further details here, but it's a really helpful tool for us to make us work efficiently. You might wonder why there is a black bar. So below this black bar is an embargoed bug. We handle embargoed bugs also in the SUSE security team. We honor the so-called responsible disclosure process. Basically, where a reporter can tell us, I want to disclose this issue and publish it in 2 weeks. And we say, okay, we honor this embargo, but we prepare updates already in the background so that the customers will get, or the users will get the update as soon as it gets public. We are also parts of various mailing lists and other pre-disclosure forums where we get knowledge of security issues beforehand so that we can have updates ready on the time when they get released. Next slide, please. So what are the next steps? Next step is the update submission part. So this actually the task of the packager. The packager sees this bug report, he prepares updates, submits updates to us, and then it gets back to us as the update manager then takes this submission, writes metadata around it, a single line summary, multi-paragraph description, and also lists the issues fixed in XML format in a so-called patch info. Every of those details will be later visible in emails and patch information and via super patch and so on. It checks if the update builds, and once everything is shiny there, pushes it to QA. Our QA teams test the update. We do both automated and manual testing. On the OpenSUSE side, it's largely open QA testing these days. Once QA has finished testing and considers everything good, then it approves the internal review, and the security team, the update manager, in the end releases the update. The update manager also does then additional documentation work like closing the bug entry. Next slide, please. Also internally, we developed a secondary tool called Smelt that helps us managing the huge amount of updates that we process. So internally, the maintenance and security team process and release around 40, 50 updates per week. So keeping a good overview of that is really necessary, and we have developed this own overview tool for us that is currently the fourth generation, I think, of that tool. It's not visible to the outside. To the outside, the build service shows a similar view in the incidents view. So if you go to the OpenSUSE colon maintenance project and click on the incidents view, you will see a similar view for the OpenSUSE maintenance incidents. Next slide, please. So what did we deliver from the incident response from reactive work? Of course, the updates themselves. We deliver notifications for every update. For SLI, we deliver them to the web. We send out emails, both for SLI and also, of course, for OpenSUSE. We have CVF data for OpenSUSE and SLES. CVF is the common vulnerability reporting format where every security advisory is presented in an XML format. There is work ongoing upstream to replace this with the next generation of that, the so-called CSAF, which is a JSON-based format. And we will switch to that or use that as soon as it becomes standardized. We also auto-generate more information, for instance, per CVE web pages, both for OpenSUSE and SLI, and also OVAL data that can be processed by SCAP tooling like OpenSCAP. Next slide, please. I have prepared some statistics. So this looks at 2018 versus 2019 to compare full years. Overall, we processed a total number of 2,500 CVEs compared to 2,700-2018, meaning processed, meaning that these could affect either OpenSUSE or SLI. We opened altogether 2,000 bugs compared to 2,200 last year, 2018. What shines out of that numbers is that we opened around twice the number of Linux kernel bugs in 2019. Reason for that is that the Linux kernel is getting more attention security-wise. There is also a fuzzing framework based on the syscaller tool that is extremely good in spotting all interesting kernel bugs and security issues. So there is a lot of usage of this tool, and it caused in turn of a lot of more security issues for the kernel. We released around 2,400 updates for SLI in the year 2019 and around 1,000 updates for OpenSUSE. Of that, and to show how good the SLI imports work, we have around 60% of those imported from the SLI updates. So less work for the OpenSUSE community. CVEs fixed altogether were 2,300. same as 2018. You see that both OpenSUSE and SLI approximately got 1,800 CVEs fixed. There's a lot of overlap between those, of course, but some packages are only on OpenSUSE. Some issues only affect SLI because SLI also has older versions of kernels and so on. Yeah. Next slide, please. So I let me hand it over to Johannes.
Thank you very much, Markus. So reactive security means we deal with security issues that are already known. Proactive security means we try to improve our security posture upfront. So our goal here is to make our products as secure as possible before we ship them. And for that, we have one primary tool. This is our SUE of bots that we use to automatically check during either build or also during submission for security issues or for stuff that we want to check. So one thing we definitely always want to check is non-default permissions. So for example, if you try to package something where you use a set UID bit, then we want to have a look. Set UID means that if you run a given binary, then you don't run it with your own privileges, but then you run it with the privileges of the owner of this file. And most of the time that's used to run something as root, even though you call it as a user. And that is pretty dangerous because that might allow you to escalate your privileges. And because of that, we want to look there. So anytime you use a set UID bit or a set GID bit, which is the same for groups, or some capabilities, which is basically the root privileges split up in smaller pieces, then we want to check this. Also for dbus services, the reason here is that this allows you to maybe attack a component that's running under different privileges. So we want to check if you ship dbus services. We also have PolicyKit rules under control. So PolicyKit is the mechanism that allows you to transparently do actions that usually require privileges without having to gain root privileges or without having to authenticate. So for example, if you want to shut down your computer, that's usually a privileged action, but we have PolicyKit rules for that that allows you to do this without having to enter your root password. But of course, we also want to check if this is done in a secure way. Nowadays, we also check PAM modules. So these are modules that control how authentication happens on the system and also various other aspects. And they are also security relevant, so we check these. We also nowadays request from maintainers that they whitelist cron jobs. So we just had quite a few security issues that we found in cron jobs. So we said we want to have a look there. And there are many other dangerous constructs in packaging. So especially in last year, we looked through all of the post and pre sections because those run as root. And if you're not careful there, then you can introduce security issues. And now we monitor all the changes there. And since RPM lint is very important for us, we also check if a maintainer suppresses RPM lint warnings. If you package software, then you probably have seen RPM lint, and you might also have suppressed some warnings, which is okay for some warnings, but not for the security critical warnings. So we improved there a lot in the last 2 years. So we added a lot of additional vectors that we consider. For example, we now check devices. We also whitelist content, not just file paths. So for quite a while, we only said, okay, you can place your file here to create a dbus service. But nowadays, we check the content of this file so that it can't be changed afterwards. We try to get unique whitelist for each code stream. That is still ongoing because it's kind of difficult because people like to merge these back. But with that, we want to have the ability to really fine-grained control for each code stream, what's allowed there. We improved the process of maintaining these whitelists quite a bit. So if you look in GitHub, we there have a repository for the permission package, and we now use this as a primary source. And since we use RPM lint a lot and the RPM lint setup is a bit tricky in our products. We improve the visibility there to ensure that they are up to date and that we have better visibility. And what might be most interesting to you is we now vary the badness of warnings between home projects and products. So let's say you package a setuid binary. It used to be the case that then your build would fail because you get a warning with a high badness. And if you don't intend to submit this to OpenSUSE but only use it in your home project, then that didn't make a lot of sense. So nowadays you get a warning, but only with a small badness. So then you can decide, okay, if you actually want to ship this to OpenSUSE, you need to go through a review. But if you need it only for your own, then you can ignore it. And I want to give a shout out to Matthias Gerstner because he was the driving force behind a lot of this. I can't count the times where he said, well, that looks strange. Let's add a different whitelist for that. So a small example, if you've been packaging, you have seen some of that. So this is one of the messages you might see during build. So in this case, there's a run job that was added and it's not authorized. It only gets a badness of 10 because it's built in a home project. But still, if you see something like that and if you want to include this into an official product, then please talk to us as soon as possible. We have a lot of work to do and we need to prioritize this. And as soon as you submit this to an official product, the badness will increase and then the package will not build anymore. So we also want to add new compiler hardening flags. So we had great success with that in the past that we added compiler hardening flags that then, helped us when new security issues came out and we were not vulnerable by default. We review and audit other new components that are introduced. And also we check for changes in the build service itself. So the build service is a central component, not only for OpenSUSE, but also for SUSE. And if there's a new source service in there, we want to have a look to see if this is done in a secure way. And more recently, we had some more time. And because of that, we actually started to do proactive code reviews for daemons listening on the network. So for example, Matthias just did an awesome audit of KDE ConnectD. And you can see his results either in the bugs or on open on the security mailing lists. So this is pretty great work from him. Our security audits are rolling, so they are based on the OpenSUSE factory development, and we base them on packages, basically. So quite often we get an audit request for a given package because they want to use a certain functionality, but we also do audits on final products. So I mentioned that before, if a new leap is released, then we will check it out and see if the security baseline is held up and if there are any things that might concern us. And most of our work for SUSE is actually done in OpenSUSE Factory. This is a win-win situation because for us, it's easier to change things in OpenSUSE Factory. And sooner or later, it will roll down to official SUSE products. And it's a benefit to the community because we help to improve OpenSUSE itself. And also to give you some numbers, so in 2018, we had 74 audits, and in 2019, that grew to 113. So we definitely had more work in the last 2 years. Although it's kind of difficult to compare those numbers, because a single audit can either be a lot of work or not that much work at all. So what are our challenges? So the first of all, of course, is we don't have enough hours in the day. I think that's probably the case for everyone. But especially for us, it's kind of rough to really find the time to do everything that we want to do. Then we have competing demands. And that is the usual problem that you have in security, that security and usability not always go hand in hand. And we sometimes have a missing granularity or misuser decisions for our existing mechanisms. So, for example, we have Polkit profiles that are either more easy to use and not that secure, or more secure and then less easy to use. And we think about ways to make this more granular so that we don't only have these two broad decisions, but maybe can decide on a more fine-grained way. And then, but this is more a problem on the SUSE side, some customers just run very old software. And then we might, for example, don't have some open flags that we want to use for a given security technology, but it's mostly not a concern for OpenSUSE. So our roadmap, we want to do more for OpenSUSE in, let's say, tracking OpenSUSE, as Markus mentioned, but we also want to do more on the SUSE side. So there are SUSE products where we currently don't have that much visibility, like the container products. We work on embedding engineers in the product teams to ensure that the products are developed in a better way. And we also want to renew our efforts around AppArmor and maybe SE Linux, because that becomes more important with the SE Linux usage in MicroOS, for example. There are some efforts around CFI, that stands for Control Flow Integrity. So that is a mitigation technique that prevents modern attacks where the control flow of a program is diverted, and modern CPUs give some hardware support to prevent attacks like this. And of course, we always strive for more manpower and then also more automation, because just having more people is not really enough. The workload grows faster than we can add new people. So where you can actually help if you want to. So the tracking stuff that Markus explained works mostly fine, we would say. And there it's kind of difficult to work with the community, because we get these private security disclosures. And there it's difficult to work with community members, because we can't share this information. But we always need help with fixing issues that we track. So that is definitely a good way to learn about security. If you want to dive in this field, then just look for security bugs that are not fixed for a while, where the maintainer is inactive, and dive in there. And as AppArmor is still the technology used for OpenSUSE, creating additional profiles or improve the existing ones is always something where we're interested in. We unfortunately don't have the time to do that, at least in the moment. But if you're interested there, then we would be happy to cooperate with you. So with that, we are through, and we still have 2 minutes left. I had to hurry a bit at the end. Do we have any questions for us?
I'm honestly just a little comment here. I'm super excited about how you guys have been doing work over the past year, especially you, Johannes. Your work on SE Linux stuff has made me very happy, very personally. And hopefully, you know, maybe at some point soon I can help with some of that, since I have some SE Linux experience. But yeah, you guys are great. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you very much. So since you mentioned SE Linux, since 2 weeks, I think, the SE Linux policy is once again OpenSUSE Factory. And it's actually more or less usable. And here a big shout out to our friends from Fedora, because they did a lot of the heavy lifting in developing this policy. If you're interested in trying out SE Linux, then if you run Factory or Tumbleweed, you can probably do that without breaking your system completely. But please do it with a system where you have physical access, because it still might break.
Yeah. Well, the libexector change should have made it so that the policies more or less completely apply without that much changes, because now we don't have all the file paths being like wildly different. Mm-hmm. But so it should mostly work now. That's pretty much why I pushed to get that in.
Yeah, I use it on my personal servers and on my desktop in enforcing mode for quite a while, and I actually don't see any breakage. But of course, SE Linux is really, really tight, that might be completely different for you, but we will only notice that if people actually try it out. So if you run into issues, then feel free to open bugs. We don't officially support that, but I'm happy to help if I find time for that.
And of course, patches are welcome in Fedora SE Linux policy repo or SUSE stuff.
Yeah, I know. That is definitely on my to-do list.
So there is a question on the chat from Kevin. So about sleeve 15, FIPS 140-2 validation status. So for the FIPS validation status, we filed for the sleeve 15 GA for OpenSSL, kernel, libgcrypt, that is currently under review at government, at the NIST, that will hopefully be receiving certificates soon. 15 SP2, we are also submitting those. That will take a while because the NIST is currently taking around 8-9 months to review everything. So that will become available begin of next year. And you also mentioned the stick status. So the stick status is really depending on the DISA, the Defense Information Systems Agency in the United States that is doing this work together with us. And it's going kind of slow. So the stick for /15, we currently forecast it to be either ready end of this year or begin of next year. So that is kind of challenging time-wise. And secure stick deployment, I think we investigated something like system roles in the installer that deploy a secure system profile.
Sorry. Yeah. Sorry to jump in here, but the next talk is starting here. So I would suggest that we move to this discussion room. So if anyone is still interested in discussing this with us, we will be available there. And we
Worry, I'm the next one, and feel free to finish, Markus. I mean, the next one is around maintenance, so it's fine. Don't worry.
Okay.
So just to wrap up, so the stick, the formalized stick that we do with STISA, that is just taking time because it's a long process, also with a kind of intransparent government body. And we are looking at the security certification or better hardening secure in the installer workflow, but currently we don't really have a good grasp on how to do that yet. So that's something that very likely will come in the next year. That we deploy a pre-hardened, stick-hardened system, either for SLES or also for Leap in the future. The community sadly cannot really help much there. But what we are doing is we are looking also at compliance as code. So far, our involvement has been a bit limited due to strategy internally. But that's something that we also plan to pick up in the future. So that's Red Hat-driven project that covers a lot of these hardening stick, like CIS-style rules. Okay. If there are no further questions, then yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. So we will be around, or at least I will be around in this discussion, in this conf chat room for further questions for the next few minutes if there are any people that have any. And thank you very much for your attention.